Where do you find somebody, you know, that really knows the story?
User scripts.
How do I do you know anybody here, Ellen, who's keen and who either would know who to get or would be helpful themselves? The trouble with the IBM manual is that if you want something specific to look up, it's very good, but it's very hard to sit down and read the whole IBM manual.
That's not hard to read at all.
No. But
is that the Norton book?
Richard Allen King.
No.
Is Norton good?
You need the Peter Norton book.
What's it called?
I've got it at home. I didn't bring it with me.
I think I know what it is. Why, is he good?
Yes, he's very good.
Good at explaining, huh?
Yep.
Maybe he could come over here and give me a $250,000 tutorial and does too.
He's going to pay you or you're going to pay him?
What does the guy do, Alan?
He's a software hotshot.
And you're talking about for more
on neither ATI nor CDEX.
Okay. I would say that the Lotus thing is useful for someone who hasn't the faintest idea of what the thing's supposed to do.
I'm pretty good at generalized statements, but when I'm asked, what is this? I still can't tell somebody what Paths of Glory is about, you know, without sounding like a bad synopsis of it.
Film directing, I think, is a misnomer for anybody that seriously wants to make films, because directing the film is only, you might say, one-third of the process. You know, writing the film, directing the film, and then editing the film is, you might say, the whole job. And it is really, it's only the old major studio image of how a film was made, that the producer held in his hand on the palette, you know, the various people, the artist, the cameraman, the actors, the film editor, and the director and so forth. And the director was really just sort of like a senior member of the crew. And that, you know, he had no real integrating status in what happened. I mean, there were the few exceptional characters, even in the days of the great days of the Hollywood studios, who somehow exerted their authority over what went on. But and even today, you know, you talk about directors have the right of, they call the first cut, which means they must approve the first cut. But then after, then the producer can do whatever he wants.
So it's a meaningless right, in other words.
Virtually, and it's a right to try to persuade someone. Because, I mean, if you don't even have the right of the first cut, you can't even explain what you want. But I have, you know, I do the cutting myself.
It is fun accumulating the information. That's part of the problem, that you have to learn something, you know, in depth about something that you start off knowing very little about. It has to have the appearance of being realistic. You know, since part of the problem of any story is to make you believe things that are more crucial, like people's, the behavior of the characters in the story. Certainly getting a realistic atmosphere and an interesting atmosphere, especially if it's not a contemporary period, is, you might just say, you know, just necessary as a starting point.
I totally failed to recognize what I didn't know about making films or anything, you know. I just thought, well, these other two things have turned out pretty well, but they were documentaries, and
the second thing had turned out pretty well.
Yeah, but I didn't really know what I didn't know, and I thought, well, Christ, there really can't be very much more to making a feature film, and I certainly couldn't make one worse than the films that I kept seeing every week, and I wasn't satisfied to just make an interesting film. I wanted it to be a very poetic and meaningful film. And it was a little bit like the Thurber story about the midget, you know, who wouldn't take the bass on balls and decided to swing, you know. That I could do a documentary film with an original music score and everything for about $3,500. So I thought, gee, if they're making these pictures for $40,000 and I can make them for $3,500, surely I must be able to sell them and at least get my money back and probably make a profit, you know? So In fact, I think we thought that we could make a considerable profit because we assumed that if they were making them for $40,000 a piece, that they must be making a profit, you know? And so I rented a 35mm IMO camera, that's spelled E-Y-E-M-O, which is a spring-wound camera, produces a professional picture. And I did a documentary film about a boxer named Walter Cartier, who I had previously done a picture story for Look about, and I knew him. And it was called Day of the Fight. And got the whole thing, you know, did everything. Alex helped me, you know, sort of carried lights around and assisted me. And I did the whole thing, just myself and Alex and Walter and his people that he knew. And at one point I said to them, you know, Christ, why are you offering us so little for this? You know, one reel shorts, you know, get more than $40,000. And they said, what, you must be crazy. And I said, why do you think that? And so I told them about the March of Time. And anyway, they said it was, you know, was ridiculous. And shortly after that, the March of Time went out of business for the reason we later found out that they were spending approximately, I mean, you know, if the March of Time sues me for this, Alex somehow found out when he was working there that it was costing $40,000 to make one of their one reelers. And they went out of business. Well, anyway, I finally sold the film to RKO Pathé, who are no longer in business either, and sold it for about $100 less than it cost me to make it. I know it was a small loss, but I had the pleasure of seeing it shown, and you know, I remember I went to the Paramount Theater where it was playing with some Ava Gardner Robert Mitchum picture, and you know, it was very exciting to see it on the screen. And it got a nationwide and worldwide distribution. And so I thought everybody liked it, and they thought it was good. And I thought that this would be, I'd get millions of offers, from which I got none to do anything. So,
well, I don't remember in what context I said it, but it isn't really contradictory, because certainly in the actual making of the movie, all the chess analogy becomes more more valid, because you're always pitting sort of time and resources against quality and ideas, and you know, is it worth you know, spending another day on this? You know, how good is it? What could I do? So you're always trying to balance you know, your resources against the time. That's perhaps what I was talking about. But in terms of the story, you know, the part of the film that is not you know, the part of the story, the part of the thing that has to do with telling the story, which is essentially what I'm sort of talking about, works pretty much the way I said. And this is also why it's never particularly, never leaves you in a very good position to come up with the, you know, the four liners. Because the process, I mean, it isn't careless, and it isn't just sort of off the cuff, and it isn't, you know, you write it on the paper and you shoot it, but it's never really, like, as I say, structuring a logical argument, which would then leave you with some very good, neat ways of coming in on your answers. Do you play chess?
No.
Well, the chess analogy has more to do with like tournament chess, you know, where you have a clock.
Yes.
And you have to make a certain number of moves in a certain time where you forfeit, even if you're, you know, a queen ahead or something. And so, you know, you see the grandmaster chess things where the guy, you know, has 3 minutes left on the clock and 10 moves left. And he'll spend, you know, 2 of those minutes on one move, which he knows if he doesn't get that one right, it's going to be lost anyway. And then he makes the last 9 moves, you know, in a minute. And he may have done the right thing. Well, you always have decisions like that, because you don't have, I mean, despite all of the sort of apocryphal stories about me, almost all of which are untrue, You don't have unlimited resources, and they do watch the budget, and you know, you do have to account for what you're doing, and so you're always trying to balance, you know, resources against the outcome.
I was taught to play chess at the age of 12, but did not play seriously until about age of 17, when I joined the Marshall Chess Club in New York on West 10th Street, between 5th and 6th Avenue.
Okay. Whatever came along. Did you have any particular intellectual interests as a child? Did you remember? I mean, were you an avid reader or?
No, I had few intellectual interests as a child. I was a school misfit and considered you know, reading a book schoolwork. And I don't think I read a book for pleasure until after I graduated high school.
Well, what were you?
I wasn't hustling chess, but I was playing chess for quarters. I mean, I wasn't a hustler in that I pretended not to be a good player and beat people. I just was playing in the park, you know, for quarters, quarter a game.
But were you actually, were you doing this for the fun of it, or were you also hoping to make
no,
a living?
No, I was doing it for the fun of it, but I also did make about $2 or $3 a day, which it really goes a long way if you're not buying anything except food.
Yeah.
I was a pretty good chess player. I used to play in the Marshall and the Manhattan Chess Clubs in New York. I was not, obviously, a great chess player, but it teaches you to overcome the initial excitement of something that looks good and to analyze it. Even Bobby Fischer or Karpov cannot see to the end of the game. I mean, they can analyze deeper than anybody else, but they none of them can see all the way. Part of the decision is based on the analysis and the rest on the feeling. When you're making a film, basically you have to, once you start, you have to make most of your decisions on some sort of intuitive basis. There really isn't time. You have to make some of your decisions that you couldn't possibly really sit down and analyze to any great extent. But at least, even if you stop for a minute, you will prevent yourself from making a mistake where something looks initially attractive, but when you really think about it, it isn't right. It's more, I would say chess is more for preventing you from making mistakes than it is for giving you ideas. The ideas seem to come spontaneously and seem to be born whole. But the discipline of examining them and not just saying, oh, that sounds great, I think that's something which chess teaches. It also teaches you to, you know, thinking on a movie. There's millions of people moving around. You know, money is being spent at a very rapid rate. Most of the mistakes you see in films are really because people just don't even, I mean, it wouldn't, if they avoided the mistakes, you wouldn't see so many things that everybody in the audience sees as stupid. But nobody seemed to realize it when they were doing it. I think it's really because there's an awful lot of filming that goes on where people literally just don't think for a moment. They get an idea, they just do it. Oh, I have, are you a computer man?
I use it.
Yeah, I have, you know, a Compaq 2, you know, the 286. It's called the Compaq 286, you know, 20 megabyte hard drive. And I use you know, word processing, database, and spreadsheet. Which is tremendous help. I mean, my God, it's like the dreariness of keeping track of things.
Why did I choose a hard drive? You could ask me that question about every film I've made, and it would be difficult for me to answer.
Mm-hmm.
I read a lot, and obviously always looking for a film story.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a little bit like somebody saying, why did you fall in love with your wife? Something happens when you read a story that you like. It suggests the possibilities of the film. Mm-hmm. And I thought that this plot was one of the cleverest of its genre, and one of the most interesting, and when I read it, I just wanted to make a film of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if these things do work that quickly, the thing that does take all the time is to extract, say, 2 hours and 15 minutes of a story and really keep distilling and distilling and distilling and distilling and distilling. I would say that if you count the time that's spent during the shooting day also working on the story in rehearsal and rewriting it and so on, I would say that an average of at least 4 hours a day has been spent on this story, much more than that, because in the real solid writing period it was like 8 hours a day. But let's just say it averaged 4 hours a day for 2 years. Say an average of 6 days a week, that's 24 hours a week times maybe 100 weeks. I'd say there's a good 2,400 hours spent on call it 2 hours and 40 minutes of story, so that's about 1,000 to 1, isn't it?
Yeah.
On the story. Now that's where the real crunch is put.
The critical opinion on my films has always more or less been settled by what I would call subsequent critical opinion. I mean, the initial reactions to most of the films are usually wrong, or a lot of them are wrong. Whether they don't get the handle on it immediately and don't know how to deal with it in the sort of hour and a half they've left to write the review, or what. But somehow, with most of the films, the subsequent critical opinion is the one that establishes it, you know, as an important film, where if you read some of the initial reviews on all of them, this seems to be true of a lot of films. I was amazed to read some of the reviews of Citizen Kane when it came out. And they weren't particularly, they weren't very impressed with it.
Really?
I was amazed, for instance, when Dr. Strangelove came out. You know, I mean, not only wasn't it appreciated by various important critics, but it was really vitriolically attacked. Bosley Crowther in The Times wrote a piece where I think the headline said, "Moscow gold could not buy more harm to America," and that sort of stuff. And strangely enough, you couldn't say, well, liberals liked it. William Buckley wrote a terrific review of it, and you could not tell where their support would come from. Loudon Wainwright in Life magazine wrote an editorial where he compared the criticism of the film with the then criticism from some Soviet general, you know, saying that Russian artists should, you know, do this, that, or the other thing. Where Life actually came out, you know, Life came out and supported the film. So you couldn't, you know, subsequently it's hard to believe that people, you know, could you know, that there'd be this sort of reactions.
What do you think of supernatural power?
You mean, what do I really think of it?
Yes.
Well, I don't know. I think that there have been so many interesting stories and reports of people who have had occult experiences. It's a little bit like when there was a famous astronomer who was talking about life in the universe. You know, in other worlds in the universe, and he said, sometimes I think there is, and sometimes I think there isn't. He said, in either case, I find the idea quite staggering,
mm-hmm.
And I think that I would be surprised in a way if there was, and I would be surprised if there wasn't.
Well,
in this case, it was the fiction. Just like everybody else, I'm fascinated by the various experiments and the stories which have been published about ESP and you know, psychokinesis, but it certainly didn't start with a desire to do something on that subject. The book was sent to me in a manuscript form by John Calley. I've always enjoyed the genre, and I felt that I hadn't really seen a picture that presented, you know, that genre. There have been pictures which have had shocks in them and which have had some wonderfully gory or horrific moments, but to properly, you know, present the, you know, that type of a story in a way where you could disbelieve and get involved in the story and
you know, the supernatural events were presented in a way, you know, which seemed dramatically realistic. What I found so ingenious about the way the novel was written, as the various supernatural events occurred, you always wonder to yourself, how is the writer ever going to explain this? The way the story is written, you assume, as you read it, that the things that are happening are probably going to be a product of his imagination. And I think this allows you to start accepting them and not worry. It isn't really until the bolt is open that you're absolutely certain that it isn't a product of imagination, because he couldn't open the bolt. I think it's entirely possible that ESP has been proven to exist, and that even other forms of the occult and psychokinetic experiments and reports are true, but I wish somebody would prove it a little more conclusively. Mm-hmm. It's also possible that it's the kind of thing which cannot be tested in the way that they've tried. I've certainly seen behavior in dogs and cats seem fairly conclusive proof that there is a non-verbal form of mental communication. I have a cat who hates to have her cub combed. And, I mean, this has happened, I should think, a dozen times. I've only to sort of touch her and think about it, not even move, and she'll suddenly just dive under the bed and hide. Before I even move, now I touch her all the time, she often has knots. Now, I think to myself, well, I must be, maybe I'm doing something, I'm moving. I think that in some way, she
et l'explication, can ce n'est pas tell
that I'm
compte.
Thinking. Mm-hmm. Telephone ring.
There's more to come, Phil, come on.
Get the dummy. No, she isn't carrying him. That's right. Okay, let's go.
Can I have the finder, please? The 18. 18 in the tube. Swing it all back in here. Yeah, it's got to go outside. That was time.
It is 25 to 1.
Well, I don't sympathize with Shelley. It doesn't help you, wouldn't it?
Yes, it does. It does. Yes, I know.
Right, okay.
But I mean, most films are like, they're almost like an athletics contest, depending on where the ball bounces and where people are standing. Opportunities arise, which, if you can exploit, just make it better. Novelist James Joyce quote, he said something about accidents suddenly open up entrances into things that you hadn't thought of, and obviously if you exploit them correctly, they add a dimension to what you're doing, which if you ignore, is very limiting.
Well, I was interested in whether or not I was going to get blown up by an H-bomb prior to Lolita. But my interest intensified itself sort of concurrently with that. I believe that the Berlin crisis took place during Lolita, and about that time I became keenly interested and started reading up on all the, you know, literature, of which there is a terrific extent, you know, a tremendous a lot. Boy, am I getting fucked up on that. A tremendous a lot.
We fucked around for an hour and 20 minutes.
No, they were, we had change. Then we had, I mean, I know it seems like a lot of tea breaks, but we had the tea break that was up at, over there. We had that when he
Sorry.
Did his knee.
You mean you had a tea break at 4 o'clock? And
no.
You have a tea break at 6 o'clock?
No, this is a fresh tea break. He came up to me for the tea here.
No, but if you had a tea break at 4, you don't have to break for this tea break. This must just be a, you know, a complimentary tea break. If you broke for tea at 4, you don't have to break for tea at 6, at quarter to 7, then break for a meal at 7:30. So figure it out.
I prefer to do that in the morning, because it gives me more fucking headaches, poxy tea breaks, and
okay, I'll get
fucking sling them right down that fucking piss hole.
Right, Terry.
Right. Sort of memory you need, though, Stanley.
That's right.
So long ago that I'm just trying to remember. Well, how was the one where Sterling Hayden dies in the end? Isn't that right?
No, he gives up. The money blows away at the airport, and he gives up.
I'm very confused.
You probably haven't seen the picture.
No, I remember Sterling Hayden very clearly, but I can't.
You're thinking of the S-Ball Jungle. That's why you thought Marilyn Monroe was in it. He dies at the end of the asphalt jungle in a field with a horse.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, you're thinking of the wrong picture. You never saw the killing.
Maybe that's right.
Yeah. If you want to see it, there's a print at the Museum of Modern Art.
Do you have this kind of ability, the supernatural power?
Say that again?
Do you have supernatural power ability of supernatural power?
No, I wish
by yourself. You know, people said that you must have, predicting the future and reading the minds of actors and getting image from another dimension.
Well, I wish I could say that I did have supernatural power. No, I think I just try to do the best that I can and hope that people like it.
Yeah.
Although persuasive isn't even the right word, because I tend to believe that if you're right, people realize it.
Are you usually right, Stanley?
Well, I try to be. No, but I have found that when I am right, you know, when in retrospect it turned out to be always right, and in doing it, it seemed right, and so on, that you do not usually find difficulties arising if you're right, unless the actor is incapable of doing what you're asking him to do for limitations of his talent or his emotional range or something, and he gets insecure and thinks of a lot of reasons why you're wrong, but really what he's trying to do is avoid failing, you know. But then really you should try to figure out what the limitations of the actors are and never put them in a spot like that.
They should only do it when they say, "This is my gun." And then let go again. This is for fighting. This is for fun.
This is my rifle. This is my gun. This is for fighting. This is for fun.
Okay, one other thing. There's three beats on when you do it. It should be three shakes. This is my gun. No, in time to the thing. This is my rifle. This is my gun. This is for fighting. This is for fun. So give it three, because a lot of people are just still touch and go with what they're doing.
On the conversations, everybody, just mouth them. Don't speak. And don't...
Joe, please.
Don't nod your heads when you're talking. Just talk naturally to each other.
Okay, right. Let's have a big clearance in the set then, please.
Okay, number one.
If you have, 20 minutes to try to figure out if somebody can act, the best way to do it is to talk to them for, say, 5 or 6 minutes, and then tell them to go out of the room and come in again and go over the same thing and tell them that they must answer the questions as if, without betraying in any way that you've just gone over the same ground. So being able to say what you've said before as if you've never said it again is really quite a good acting exercise.
How do you direct actors?
Well, first of all, you discuss the character in general, and then you discuss the scene. You know, what the character's real attitude is in the scene, which frequently isn't exactly what it appears to be, in terms of the
La ligne.
Then comes this terrible moment of the first time that you actually rehearse a scene in the place you're going to shoot it. It's always a surprise. It's never what you thought it would be. The text usually has to be changed in some way or another. New ideas occur, old ideas are dropped. And at that point, it then becomes relatively easy. The actual shooting usually is not the problem. The problem is before you're ready to shoot. Once everybody knows what they're doing, and you know that it's good or interesting, the train really is making the thing happen. It's doing what it should do.
Well, many parts of that were good. There were quite a few fuck-ups, but many parts of it were very good. Let's look at it.
I want to play it back, please. Let's look it up, boys.
You didn't do it. Through here, I couldn't tell. I didn't think you got mean enough at the beginning when you said... The only thing... Come and look at it, Shane. The only part clearly wrong was at the end when you said, "We've got to get him out of here," as you got strong at the end, and I think it has to be a last desperate begging, And I still think you shouldn't jump on every single emphatic line. It looks fake. It really does. It looks like you... Shelley, I'm telling you, it's too many times. Every time he speaks emphatically, you're jumping, and it looks funny.
But it always happens with the actors that themselves have been unprepared. Actors are sometimes undisciplined enough not to go home and go to sleep at night and learn their lines, and they go out and they come the next day and they haven't learned the lines. They cannot act without knowing dialogue. If you have to think about anything when you're acting, even if you can say the words, if you have to think about the words, you cannot work on the emotion. And even thinking about the words make mistakes, I mean, you're just miles away from what you're doing. So it's happened on every film, you know, where somebody will do this pretty consistently. And once they start, there's not much you can do about it. I mean, you can fire them on day one and maybe replace them. But when you get into day 12, you know, you can threaten them, you can cajole them, you can try to appeal to their sense of what reputation they're creating among the crew, but it doesn't. Some people are simply not able to get themselves sufficiently together to, you know, over a period of time, discipline themselves and go home and work, you know. So they come in and they don't know their lines. So now we get into a thing where, do you start shooting? At what point do you start? So you usually start too early. They blow a lot of takes, or they're not doing it properly. So you wind up, say, with this particular actor, you know, maybe doing 30 takes of something, and every one of them is in some way fucked up because he really hasn't got a grip on it. Then the guy gets back to America, and if he's nice, he says, oh boy, Stanley's such a perfectionist. He does 100 takes on every scene. I had to do this thing, you know, 100 times. So the 30 becomes 100. And, of course, they never say why you did so many takes. I don't do a lot of takes when it's good. There's no way to fake your way through it if you don't know the words. If you have to think, you cannot think about the words. And you can see it in there. You can just see a lack of concentration in their eyes, and there's no way they can do it. And, you know, you're stuck. You're standing there, there's 100 people waiting. So you either try to shoot it and hope you get something out of it in pieces, or you send them back to their dressing room, and you do nothing, and they're trying to learn the lines. So whatever happens, it's not good.
Well, what do you think of UFO, which is flying saucers, you said? Do you think, the alien people from another planet visiting our Earth?
Well, I've never really made up my mind. Again, it belongs to that category of stories that it's almost impossible to believe, and yet at the same time, some of the sightings are so extraordinary, and the people who have seen them seem so respectable and beyond, any suspicion that, one can only say that I don't know. I would like to believe it.
You get the feeling from your films, and particularly this one, that the world is at war all the time. Apes are fighting.
You know. Well, I mean, in a work of fiction, you know, you have to have conflict. You couldn't have a story where something wasn't wrong. Well, even in The Sound of Music, something goes wrong. In addition to which, it's not an inact the way most people are structured. How many happy marriages are there, and how many stepfathers love their stepsons, and how many stepsons love their stepfathers? How often do people who have ambitions which only involve money, how often do they find it satisfying, especially in his case, where it virtually paralyzes all of his activity? You know, from a sort of psychological pattern, you could say that while he is struggling and out in the world, which he doesn't like, but at least his life is vital. From the time he gets married and he accomplishes what he thinks he's going to get, everything just becomes gray and dismal and wearing away at him. He's completely unsuited for the life, and so he puts himself into a gilded cage. Then on, everything goes sour.
Cut it!
Nobody even said go visit.
has no desperation. Oh, come on. What do you mean roll video? We're killing ourselves out here, and you're going to be ready.
I am too. I'm standing right by the door. Should
we play mood music?
No, I can't.
Yeah, but
hear.
When you came out like this, you said it just.
We're sitting there because they say, wait a minute, okay. And then you say on the radio,
but when you
go.
Do it, you've got to look desperate, Shelley. You're just wasting everybody's time there.
I can't even get this door open.
Journalists, mindless perfectionism. Of journalists, you know, trying to find an interesting handle. Obviously, if you try to get something right and you work a little harder perhaps than some people do on it, if somebody wants to put the worst face on it, they'll call it mindless perfectionism. But first of all, I think the films have a quality, you know, which holds up on second, third, and fourth viewings, where you see things that you don't see the first time, you know, which is a result of the thought and care that's gone into it. You can get away with a lot, you know, if people only look at a movie once. But if you really, you know, it's like saying a writer who spends several years writing a book, maybe he could write it in 5 months. You know, is he a mindless perfectionist? All I can say is my budgets are well within reasonable limits. And the only film I've ever made which was economically poor from the studio's point of view was Barry Lyndon. Every other film has been very good from the studio's point of view, even if they haven't gone as far as giving profits to the producer, which you probably know is a very favorable formula to the studio, so that you really got to go big, big, big to get profits as a producer. So, you know, my pictures don't cost that much. I found a way to spend a little extra time on them by making them in an inexpensive way and getting the quality on the screen. And I think you know, the charge is unjustified on every level.
The last scene of Shining, you showed the picture, and
I told Julian to ask you, did you have any difficulty recognizing Jack Nicholson?
No, not me.
No.
We could find Jack Nicholson, but, you know,
that... sure what it was supposed to mean.
Right.
Well, it was supposed to suggest a kind of evil reincarnation cycle, mm-hmm. Where he is part of the hotel's history, just as in the men's room when he's talking to the former caretaker, mm-hmm. ghost of the former caretaker, who says to him, you know, you are the caretaker, you have always been the caretaker, yeah. I should know, I've always been here. One is merely suggesting some kind of, you know, endless cycle of this evil reincarnation, and mm-hmm. also, well, that's it. I mean, again, it's the sort of thing that I think is better left unexplained, but since you asked me, I'm trying to explain.
I see, okay.
One of the techniques of the novel that I did keep, that Zachary always warned you in advance. I felt that this was important because, first of all, it was in the book, and it seemed to me it kept the, it made the twists and turns of the story inevitable unless popping up like a jack-in-the-box by him anticipating major changes and warning. It immediately establishes a relationship which might be less believable without. It tends to be a story of... you know, which doesn't depend on surprise in terms of what's going to happen, but how. If you saw a film about the sinking of the
Titanic,
you didn't know that it was going to sink. You'd wonder what 90% of the film was about before it hit the iceberg. So there is another way to tell a story. There is a different kind of suspense by being told in advance of impending disaster and then seeing how it develops.
It might be better to just play it as a medium shot with the situation.
Yeah, okay.
Stay there.
Can you do with your head down? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's not bad. Do that. Try that, Jack.
Wendy, listen to me. Let me out of here and I'll forget the whole damn thing. It'll be like it never happened.
You couldn't find some way of sort of not looking at her and looking down as you say the line.
Let's get this quote. I think we ran out. The analogy of using the frustrating, wasted time periods on the set for thinking with thinking on your opponent's move and chess.
We're talking a thing about the daily working with or without cutters, which I didn't completely understand. He said that when he directs that he has a cutter who works every day, and that you do not have a cutter who works every day, and that this is somehow a good thing.
With the exception of a few directors, like David Lean, and, well, let's not say who, with the exception of a few directors, most people have their film edited by film editors as they go along. And then when the film is done, they look at the film and dictate some notes about it. And the film editor tries to do what they say, and then maybe they look at it again and they do it again. But basically, it's like trying to, redesign a city by driving through it in a car, you know. You can notice a few things and say, you know, put that traffic light in the middle of the street, or those buildings over there look kind of shabby or something. But if you really want to do it right, you must do it yourself, you know, piece by piece. So I think by now I have enough sort of ability to imagine the way a scene will come out, so that I can tell without editing the material if I have enough film coverage and, you know, what I can do with it. And then I edit the film with the editor myself when I'm all finished.
But you haven't done any editing up to now.
No. Just slinging together that thing is
probably the most, some of the most spectacular examples of film art, if you leave content out of it, are in the best TV commercials. Well, the ones that struck me, as I see, I get the pro football game sent over to me, and Michelob has done a series last year of kind of impressions of people just having a good time with the editing and the photography, and just the visual stuff is, I think, is the most brilliant I've ever seen. Have you seen any of those?
City at Night from Above, yeah. It starts. Yeah.
Something. Well, there's a variety of them. And yeah. Incredible cutting. Eight frame cuts and, you know, just beautiful. And you realize in 30 seconds they've created an impression of something rather complex. I've also thought that, you know, and I haven't done it, that no one else has, is that the ultimate way of telling a film story would have more to do with TV commercials than it does to the way they are presently told, that the economy of statement and the kind of visual poetry, which actually, you know, if, as I say, forget what they're doing, you know, selling beer or something, it's really visual poetry, that if you could ever actually tell a story with anything like that kind of approach, first of all, you could handle vastly more complex and subtle material.
Well, Japanese people love your films, especially Space Travel 2001. And but people are wondering that what is the meaning of last scene? You know, the old man were, you know, lying on the bed and in a very old style house. And could you give us an answer?
I tried to avoid doing this ever since the picture came out, because when you just say ideas, they sound foolish, whereas if they're dramatized, one feels it, but I'll try. I mean, the idea was supposed to be that he is taken in by godlike entities, creatures of pure energy and intelligence with no shape or form, and they put him in what I suppose you could describe as a human zoo. and to study him. And he spends his whole life passes from that point on in that room, and he has no sense of time. It just seems to happen as it does in the film. Mm-hmm. And they choose this room, which is a very inaccurate replica of French architecture.
Yeah.
Deliberately so inaccurate, because you know, one was suggesting that they had some idea of something that he might think was pretty, but weren't quite sure, just as we aren't quite sure what to do in zoos with animals.
Yeah.
To try to give them what we think is their natural you know, environment. And anyway, when they get finished with him, as happens in so many myths of all cultures in the world, he is transformed into some kind of super being.
Yes.
And sent back to Earth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, transformed and made you know, into some sort of Superman.
Yes.
And we have to only guess what happens when he goes back.
Huh.
It is the pattern of a great deal of mythology.
Mm-hmm.
And that was what we were trying to suggest.
I see.
Do you like writing alone? Or
I would love to write with someone who I found stimulating and on the same wavelength. The only person that I've ever felt that with was with Arthur Clarke when we were working on the original story. But when you get into the filming, let's say frequently many, many adjustments in the plot have to be made. You know, one of the paradoxes of movies is that you know, people who really can write don't write films unless they're directors, in which case, you know, they're writing for themselves.
This last sentence, they are all equal now. Huh? Christian or nihilist?
No, no, it seemed a very, they're all dead.
You believer?
No, no, it just seemed to me, and I guess to Thackeray, a very good postscript to the story.
But I'm not thinking only about Barry Lyndon, but your films in general, so you can't protect yourself. Great despair.
I wouldn't say, you know, honestly, I think that I do think that the comparison between melodrama and honesty does depend, I suppose, on the weight that you give it. But basically, if you use the all the difficulties which befall the main characters of the stories to, in the end, reinforce a belief, then you're not really saying what things appear to be. How disappointing you make the end of a film is a matter of, I suppose, taste or artistic balance, whatever it is. But, you know, you always are faced with the problem of, are you going to try to reinforce this illusion which melodrama fosters, or are you going to reflect what one sees about life?
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say that it's
nihilistic.
Yeah. No, I think it's realistic. No, I mean, does the world seem to you a benevolent and fair place?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, they want you to say, I think, you know, this is a story of the duality of man and the duplicity of governments, or something like that. And this is, you know, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I hear people try to do it sometimes in interviews. It usually is bullshit, or if the work is good, it's sort of, well, it's usually irrelevant if you've seen the thing. Fellini's very good. He just sort of makes these sort of Fellini. He just makes these jokes and says preposterous things that you know he couldn't possibly mean, and it makes it an amusing interview.